here we are on 24th, 2016 at 1544 Curran Street. And this is the view from, one of the views, from Jackie Goldberg's house. This is Patricia McGrath, the Silver Lake Neighborhood Council and the History Collective, interviewing Jackie Goldberg. So go ahead, when were you born and were you born here?
I was born in Los Angeles, downtown at California Hospital.
Okay.
November 18, 1944, I'm 71 years old. My mother was born here in Los Angeles. My father came here when he was 2 years old. My mother was born here in 1911, and her father was the first kosher meat cutter in Los Angeles.
Wow.
He was a rabbi, but he really never had a congregation, rather. Uh-huh. So he became a kosher meat cutter, and some people later knew him and some of our family because they owned Big Town Market on Pico and La Cienega, which for the Jewish community in Los Angeles, because they had kosher meats, was a place that a lot of people who wanted kosher food would go.
Right.
My dad was born in New Bedford, Massachusetts, but came here when he was two. His father was a cobbler, a shoemaker, and had his own little store. He was a small entrepreneur on Central Avenue. My parents met because my dad's mother was the best customer at my mother's father's meat store.
How cool.
And so they grew up together and they got married and they bought a home in Inglewood because they decided they did not want to live in a ghetto of any type. And they didn't know that Inglewood would be a white ghetto, but they didn't know that at the time because it was mostly bean fields when they bought there, and they didn't realize how racist the town would become. But we grew up there. Both my brother and I graduated from Morningside High School in Inglewood. Art went to UCLA. I went to Berkeley. He then came to Berkeley. And a lot of the political history we may come to later. When I had finished at the University of Chicago and almost gotten my master's degree, I hadn't finished what Chicago calls the paper.
Right.
So I came back to Los Angeles and I was trying to figure out where to live, and I decided that where I wanted to live was in some place that was near downtown, because I'm definitely an urban kid, but also had mostly single-family dwellings and not large apartment buildings. I didn't mind small 6, 10, even 15-unit buildings, but the big ones I didn't want to be around particularly because I find that it's a lot of traffic and stuff. And I found a place on Vendome Street, an apartment, in an apartment building. It was the very tippy-tippy-tippy-top one. Turned out it was the place that Laurel and Hardy were trying to take their piano.
Right, I was going to ask you
and
about the music box.
We discovered the music box, we did, by the fact that we had a summer camp called the Little Red Summer Camp, in which we took all the neighborhood kids for free on field trips and to the beach and so forth and so on, a bunch of us teachers. Let me back up a little
back
further.
Up.
One of the things that a lot of us who were in politics together in Berkeley wanted to do was to live near one another so we could do organizing together. And so as I moved on to Vendome Street, I began watching all the apartments, and we moved, our whole building was eventually people from I knew from Berkeley, except for one family that we just met had already lived there. And then we took over more places on Vendome Street, and then we took some on, a few other places, all south of Sunset. Descanso, we had a few folks, and we began little by little filling up the apartments with people from then. At the same time, Catolicos Poderosa was a group of priests and nuns who had strong ties to Central and South America because they had been those priests and nuns who had worked in those communities, who were now back. Most of them had left the priesthood and the nunnery and were marrying each other and were organizing around the big Catholic church on Wilshire, whom they saw as a terrible thing because it was spending a fortune on this building and these accoutrements when there was so much poverty amongst the Catholics.
St. Basil's?
Yeah. so much poverty. So it turned out that as I was trying to bring people into this neighborhood, they were bringing people into these neighborhoods, and we all met up with each other, and we decided to work together. So the first thing we did was organize the Echo Park Silver Lake Food Conspiracy. Now, this was a buying collective in which two or three of us would go at dawn, pre-dawn actually, down to the, not to the so-called farmer's market, but to the real place that they brought the food in on, Santee. It's now a different street, but it was
Santee. Produce.
Right. And we went through until we could find people who would be willing to sell us just one box of things. Not, we could never buy less than that. It was a whole
lugs store of market, things.
But we would buy just one crate of them. So what we did is we met together and we each put in, we said, here's how it's going to work. We're going to have no meetings. Okay, that was the first thing. Second thing was we're going to charge every family $5 to join. Whether there was one person in the family or 15, it was the same $5.
What year was this? Because they had this in San Francisco, I know, in the 60s.
Yes, this was definitely the 60s. Mm-hmm. This is 60, I'm going to say 7 or 8 mm-hmm. or 9, something in that area, in the late 60s. And then we were going to find houses in Echo Park and in Silver Lake that had big backyards. And once a week on Wednesdays, we would go down and we would buy some fruits and vegetables, and we would have people bring their own bags, and everybody who joined was assigned a job.
Wow.
Okay, and so, for example, some did set up, some did clean up, some did weighing of things.
So it was a real cooperative.
It was a real cooperative. Nobody was paid, there were no staff. We met once to organize. We met a couple of other times to figure out little wrinkles. Otherwise, there were no meetings. We had a town crier at each meeting. That would be somebody who would read the political news of the day, where a demonstration might be going on or where there were new information about a court case or something. So they would talk while people would come. You brought your own bags.
And where in the city was it?
Here, right here in Echo Park in Silver Lake.
Park and
so
Silver.
One of the places we did it was in that little park
in
on Vendome.
Yeah.
We did it in somebody's backyard on Alvarado that goes up from the little Alvarado that goes up into Echo Park
Right,
Hills.
Right, right.
We had a house in around, I'm going to say maybe Mitchell Torina, mm-hmm. across the street from Mitchell Torina School. Mm-hmm. There was one of our members had a pretty good sized backyard. We had four different backyards, and we did that because we wanted to gather people from the neighborhood
right.
at each of them. If it's at the same place, you're only gathering
exactly.
from one place. And we would go out and leaflet people. And out of this grew a number of things. First of all, we started a daycare center, the Echo Park Silver Lake People's Child Care Center, which is still there on, what's that street? I can't think of it. Took my kids there and everything else there, and I don't know.
Is it north or south of Sunset?
It's north of Sunset, and it's east of Alvarado and Glendale Boulevard, but I can't remember.
It's not Griffith Park Boulevard.
No, it's
the one up by
right over the hill.
The one.
It's north of
south of Gateways, off of Land.
North
Cullum,
of Gateways.
McCullum,
North of Gateways. Where yes,
that
exactly.
Street comes together because
yes, exactly.
I actually sent my kids there.
Okay. Okay. So that was that came out of the food conspiracy.
Oh my God.
Out of also came a kind of a free shop that on down by where Glendale comes just before it splits off onto First and up on Beverly.
Okay.
There's some little shops actually on
right.
Glendale Boulevard down there.
Mm-hmm.
We rented one of those shops, and mostly it was the Catolicos Poderosa, the OLX priests and nuns. They set up a center in which they collected things like bedding and clothing mm-hmm. and so forth, and people came for free. There was no cost.
Wow.
It was come and if you had things, bring them
right,
there, and
right.
we started called the Free Store. A little bit later, we started the People's Echo, which was a bilingual newspaper that talked about the food conspiracy, told some of the prices. We sold them for a quarter. If people didn't want to give us a quarter, we gave it to them. And so we organized south of Sunset through all of Silver Lake, and all of Echo Park and down the Temple Beverly corridor as well. And at our height, I would say the food conspiracy probably had 200 families that kind of came most every week. We would go down, three of us. We had one big truck. And the deal was we would buy fruit and vegetables, not by order, but by what were the good bargains with good fruit, not dying fruit or dying vegetables, but good things, but on bargain, because it was long in the market that week. We'd bring it back and we'd establish a price based on what we paid. On Echo Park Avenue was a restaurant called Eating High.
Yes.
They bought everything we didn't use for a fixed price each week, which kind of meant we never went broke if things didn't sell. And then individuals in the food conspiracy could say, well, for example, we weren't using bell peppers because we weren't sure enough people would buy them to buy a crate. Mm-hmm. So Minnie, whom we later renamed Bell Pepper Minnie, put out three recipes for making, for using bell peppers.
Wow.
With. And so we bought a crate of bell peppers and put the recipes up on tags so that people could take them with them. And people loved them. We bought jicama that way. We bought all kind. We bought some Filipino kinds of fruits and vegetables. We spread out based on what the people said they wanted. And then there was a group that did cleanup, that put everything away and took the excess down to Eating High and collected the money from them. Wow. We did this for about, I'm going to say 10 years.
Wow.
Because out of it grew the Little Red Summer Camp in the summer, grew the
daycare.
We had reading groups, a daycare center, we had reading study groups, we had eating groups. Okay, so I, for example, was in a Vendome eating group because a lot of us lived on Vendome. Okay, so what that meant was in our eating group, four nights a week, they were all weekday nights, we would all have dinner together. Okay?
Wow.
And whoever had an apartment or a table, and if you'll look in the dining room, you'll see a huge dining room table. It was usually at our house.
Mm-hmm.
But two people would do the main dish and the vegetable, and two people would do drinks, dessert, and a salad. And the others would do set up and clean up. And we rotated. So each of the four nights you did one of the four tasks. And the other, and we ate together. And it was fabulous. It was really fabulous. Then we started having children, which is where the daycare center came from.
How many children did you have?
We just had one, Brian.
Which you have grandchildren.
But I have grandchildren, and I had nieces and nephews.
How many grandchildren do you have?
I have just two grandchildren.
Toys.
Just two grandchildren.
Girl and a boy.
Yeah, a girl and a boy. One is about to be four, and the other's about to be six.
Okay.
And so this was our political organizing. We used it to organize people around fighting against the Vietnam War. We used it to try to convince City Hall that they should make child care more available to people. We used it to talk to them about having rent control because rents were beginning to go up and people were beginning to be forced out of their apartments. We took on a bunch of community issues. We were a part of Grace Simon's fight against the two freeway tearing down parts of Silver Lake and Echo Park. In fact,
it was supposed to go right down Benton Way.
And Vendome Street.
And Vendome.
Because
exactly.
The first day I was moving in, I met Grace Simon.
Oh, wow.
She came up to me and she said, "Dearie, don't get too settled up there because they plan to tear your building down and put a freeway through here." And that's how I got involved in Save Elysian Park and Save Echo Park and Save Silver Lake and so forth.
And you were all organized. I mean, many of you, the nuns and the priests and the
all lived
the
in
Berkeley
basic,
people, and they all kind of organized around
Echo
Vendome
Park,
too.
So, well, that was the first place
the
because
first
there
place.
Were a few apartment buildings, and as each unit came open, we filled it.
Right.
Okay.
And you also started the first kind of Laurel and Hardy kind
of
thing?
Oh yes, right. Well, then.
I mean.
As part
you
of the
realized
summer
camp, later that
as
that's
part serious. Of the summer camp, we had an outdoor film festival.
Right.
Every Friday night in that little park.
In the summer, right?
Right, in the summer. We'd put up big sheets between the two trees. I had my own 16mm camera. The County of Los Angeles Library had a huge, huge 16mm film library. And I would pulled out the Laurel and Hardy music box And we're all sitting there with, you know, maybe 30 kids and 15 adults. And the kids are starting to go, because they recognize the median strip.
Exactly.
And they knew that this must be the same place.
It was the Vendome.
It was. And we all just got hysterical and applauded and cheered, and we started telling the city, you got to do something about it. Wasn't until I was on the city council that I finally made that happen.
How many years after this was the city council?
I was on the city council from 93 to 2000, so it was about 20 years later.
Was it? Were you on the Board of Education before
first,
that?
First, yeah, 83
so
to 91.
How did you get from the 60s to the 70s to the Board of Education?
Well, it was the 80s of the Board of Education.
Yeah.
I'll come back.
Keep
to
going.
That. I just want to finish though this business. So we then also ended up saying that we needed a swimming pool in our area. We didn't have one. So the Echo Park Silver Lake pool is from there. We said we needed a library branch, that we didn't have a library branch in this huge community. So first we got the one on Temple, then we got the one on Sunset, and now we got the one over there on
Glendale Boulevard.
Glendale Boulevard. So that all came out of this energy.
This movement.
This energy that was multiracial and multiethnic. Because
and
first of all, at all cooperative, and first of all of the priests and nuns spoke Spanish because they had all been placed in Central and South America. So we had a huge bilingual group.
Wow.
And
plenty of food.
Oh yeah, plenty of food. And then we had a place on Echo Park Avenue, not too far from Sunset, because people wanted things that needed refrigeration.
Okay.
So we were getting cheeses.
Milk.
And then we went into bulk things when we had a location that we could leave things in. So we would still do the fresh stuff there every week, but we had bulk beans, bulk rice, bulk things that families needed that we could get more
this
cheaply.
This must have been the first real Los Angeles food pantry in the Central or the East Hollywood area or the
Well, it wasn't Silver Lake. A pantry. We didn't give the food away. People bought it. They brought their bags and they bought it, but they got it at basically wholesale prices for joining for $5 and agreeing to do your work when it was your turn to do your work.
Right. And you had 200 people.
And then we started babysitting co-ops.
Okay,
which for us was a delight.
And
my son still is connected to the kids that were in those babysitting co-ops, even though one of them lives in Atlanta and one of them lives in Colorado.
Wow.
But they still keep in touch because we all did that every Saturday night for
That's
years
wonderful.
And years and years. So it became a real community for us. It was one of the reasons we put the pool in, is we wanted, when I moved here, was we wanted people to have a place to swim. This was before the Echo Park pool was put in yet.
Right.
And it's still a community pool.
And
it's
you moved
fenced
here,
separate in 79.
Okay, 79.
We fenced this separately from the house for two reasons. One is so our children and grandchildren wouldn't go out the front door and fall in the pool when nobody was perhaps watching.
Right.
And secondly, so we could put a combination lock so that the neighborhood uses the pool in the summer. Everybody comes here.
Wow.
And so it becomes again, because you know really a backyard, or in this case front yard pool, a family can't use it enough to make it worthwhile.
Right.
You really can't. But
no.
If the neighborhood uses it, then it's a nice thing.
Did your parents come over to use it?
No, my parents by this time had moved out of the area and were retired and living in Murrieta Hot Springs in a double mobile home.
But they were kind of rebuffed that you put in the pool instead of remodeling
the kitchen
first.
Well, just because of the order we did it. This house was really a mess when we bought it. I mean, it
so
was
you renovated the house.
We renovated the pool before
the pool.
We renovated.
Well, there was
the
a house pool here.
No, we made a pool.
We made a pool
and then renovated the house
after.
Okay, so then the question is, how did I get into politics? Well, during the 70s, the early 70s, the Boston desegregation case ended, and Boston was to desegregate its schools. And after all of the talk about white liberals telling all of the people in the South that they were bad and evil because they had segregated their schools, of course the northern schools were just as segregated as the southern schools. They just didn't do it by law. They did it by custom. They did it by redlining. They did it by housing discrimination. They had a lot of ways to do it. They didn't have to have a law that says you can't go to school together. So in Boston, buses were burned. And there was rallies by white people. And so I talked to friends of mine and said, you know, there's a school desegregation case about to begin here in Los Angeles. we better begin organizing if we're going to not have the same thing repeat here. Because I know there are people here who are just as racist as those people who were there and who are going to fight this. And I do not want Los Angeles to be a place known as a place where the buses were burned. So we started an organization called the Integration Project. Little did we know that we were going to become interveners in the court case. It's how I met Sharon, really, is that she was one of the ones, the people who first organized me into doing this. And we began, my brother and a woman I had taught with, but who was now a lawyer, no longer teaching, were our pro bono attorneys, and Sharon and I were the staff. We did all the typing, we did all the briefs, we did all the answering of the interrogatories, and that's how we fell in love. In the middle of the night, we would be still working, Brian would be asleep in his bed, Brian was already born, and boom, 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 boom. And this went from 76 until the court case ended.
As what was the name of the court case? I can't remember.
It was...
This is way before Brown. This is after Brown versus the Board.
This is in the 70s.
Yeah.
This is long after.
Way after.
Yeah, this
But it hadn't really taken
anywhere. Well, it was the beginning of the... Yeah. It was the mid to late 70s when the ACLU and MALDEF and the NAACP sued LAUSD and said, your schools are segregated, you must do something about it. And unfortunately, they sued in state courts and not in federal courts. That was a big mistake because the state courts were very reactionary at the time. Federal courts were actually better, but not much better, but better. And so the case went on and on and on and on. But as a result of it, our little group designed a desegregation plan in which we emptied out schools between two segregated areas on paper. Okay. And we could show that everybody within 15 or 20 minute ride would go to the middle.
Right.
And the middle would go to the outside so that nobody was traveling a long distance.
Right.
Okay, and we desegregated all the high schools. We desegregated most all the middle schools, about 80% of them. There were some too far distant we couldn't reach because we set a time limit.
That was also the time the magnet schools were starting.
Right, and we desegregated about 60% of the elementary schools with our plan, none of which, of course, ever took place because in the meantime, a state legislator passed a legislation that said that busing could not be used for purposes of desegregation in the state of California.
But busing started anyway.
No, not forced busing.
But voluntary busing?
Voluntary busing was always legal.
Okay.
But busing for purposes of desegregation that people had to go because they were in a plan, their schools were to go,
what you're saying.
Was made illegal in California.
By the state?
By the state. Alan Robbins.
Oh, boy. Because I know my daughter started busing in, after she graduated from Mitchell in 78. She started busing to McCoy because it was a magnet for theater and fine arts.
There you go.
And she wanted to go.
Right, exactly.
But it was 45 minutes because they had to go everywhere. It was 15 minutes, but 45 minutes to pick up the other kids. But there was busing,
quite a bit of busing. And we also started programs like Permits with Transportation, which allowed empty schools to take more kids and so forth and so on.
Now, were you on the board? No.
Not yet. Through that experience... Right. We decided two things, the integration project I'm talking about. One was we needed to have a voice on the board. Howard Miller had been recalled because he tried to please both sides, and that gets you everybody angry at you. And the most important thing happened, board members were changed by a proposition on the ballot to be elected by district. And the reason they did that is because no board member had ever lived south of the Santa Monica Mountains. They all lived in the valley, every last one of them, except Howard Miller, who lived on the west side, and he was recalled. So we had districts. So now in a district, you might elect somebody, whereas citywide, we really didn't have a chance. You needed too much money. So Kathleen Brown... Rice at the time. She was Kathleen Brown when she was elected. She was no use. She was not interested in sticking her neck out. And we needed somebody to say they believed in school desegregation on the board, we thought. So we began holding interviews of people to run when she married the guy named Rice, who was NBC Sports in New York, and so Kathleen Brown Rice left and went to New York and vacated her just elected position. But now it was a position that was in a district. And our district, the district we'd been organizing in since the late 60s, that we got a pool in, that we got library for, that we had a food conspiracy and eating groups and
daycare
and a whole bunch of things. And so we decided we would run somebody for that seat. And in the meantime, the board had appointed an insurance salesman who was anti-school desegregation to the open seat. So he was running as an incumbent, but not an elected incumbent. So another thing, we thought maybe we could knock him off. So we started holding interviews of people who wanted to run for the seat. And we only asked one thing of them. They could be wrong, in our opinion, wrong on everything, but they had to be okay to say that, yeah, they thought kids of color and kids, white kids, should go to school together, and yeah, they ought to have some plan on how to make that happen other than just volunteerism. So that's all you had to agree to. You didn't have to agree to anything more than that yet, and you had to be willing to say that out loud. So we had a lot of people who said, yeah, that's what I think, but I think if you said that, you couldn't get elected, yeah. So I'm not going to say that. So finally we turned on each other, and a wonderful community college president of the College Guild, Marty Hittleman, and I were sent out to dinner, and they told one of us to come back and be the candidate. And so Marty and I had dinner together, and we talked about the fact that we didn't think either of us could get any endorsements at all, and then I thought maybe I could get one or two, and he thought maybe he could get one or two. And we figured out that probably I could get two actual endorsements, and he could only get one, and I became the candidate. That's really how it all happened. It wasn't on my agenda. So at that time that I ran for the school board, I was teaching in Compton full-time. I really did not feel, the primary was in June, I did not feel I could abandon my students and take time off.
Right.
So I would teach every morning from 7 a.m. until about 4 p.m., and then I'd come home and walk precincts. And then I would all weekend walk precincts, and then I'd go back and teach all week, and then I'd every afternoon and evening we'd walk precincts. And we had a real small army, and UTLA surprised everyone and endorsed me. Wow. Because there were a couple of sort of more centrist liberal candidates that had sort of had the inside track all along.
Right.
And everyone was shocked. But it was because at the interview in front of the whole house, I did better than these other folks did. Didn't hear them, so I have to take their word for it. But it changed enough minds that I got the endorsement. Well, now that I had the endorsement, besides the small army of all these people I had been working with for 20 years in this community, now I had a whole bunch of teachers who were also going out knocking on doors for me. And I came in first in the primary, but there were 9 candidates, so nobody got a majority. Right. And then I won in the runoff. And I had been endorsed by Howard Berman, who I'd known all my life. Mm-hmm.
So you had some Valley support.
Yeah. Well, there were no Valley members voted in the district. It just meant a person that people knew endorsed me. And Diane Watson endorsed me.
Nice.
And that was it. Nobody else. I mean, that was it.
Not now by your lonesome.
But we won decisively, and I spent the next 8 years on the board.
What precinct was that?
That's the district that's, well, the districts are
Is
all
there
different.
A change
they
now?
Are different, but it was Echo Park, it was Silver Lake, it was Hollywood, it was Chinatown, it was Temple Beverly Corridor. That's about it.
Yeah.
Okay. Was not Highland Park. That came with other things that I did. But so it wasn't Highland Park. I think it was Atwater. I know it was Atwater. Yeah. Okay.
So you had two terms.
I had two terms.
And didn't you organize quite a bit of the for a smaller classes and bond?
Oh yeah.
Well, that was later.
That was later. Yeah. The bond issues were later.
But when you were on
the
board.
The main things I did on the board was I started a peace curriculum, which I think is in disuse now. Nobody's kept it up because I was tired of us having only war curriculums.
Right.
We got a peace curriculum going, and it was good. I was really very strong in getting a real bilingual program that had bilingual teachers in it, as opposed to bilingual programs that had bilingual aides in them.
Right.
And I almost, but not quite, got the board to be willing to send people who wanted to be bilingual and in a bilingual program to this small school in Cuernavaca that I went to, because it was very cheap, and in 3 months during the summer, you really could be quite bilingual. I did only 1 month, and I can still speak some Spanish.
It's in
Cuernavaca. It was called CIDOC, C-I-D-O-C, and it was started by an ex-priest. And there were no grades and no transcripts. You didn't get any credit for it. And all the people who came there were people who worked with low-income people who were Spanish speakers.
And was it immersion and classrooms?
It was entirely classroom and immersion.
And
you lived with a family, and you just did it all the time. And in a month, I got what we call present tense Spanish. There's no future and there's no past.
That's what I have, too.
But I have present tense Spanish.
Vocabulary and few verbs.
Yeah.
That's what I
have. I won. I worked on that. I worked on a school-based management, which is something I still support. Mm-hmm. I helped start the whole LEARN idea of communities and parents and teachers and businesses together, helping schools, individual schools, make their own individual decisions. I don't believe in top-down management. I'm still fighting that at LAUSD.
Right.
And I got involved also with reading. And unfortunately, I miscalculated. I said that any school that had more than 20% of its kids reading two or more below grade level had to have a school-wide plan for increasing their reading. What I was pushing was for them to expand reading through the curriculum. In other words, have different types of reading materials in history and science classes that were at lower reading levels, that everybody could read something.
And learn at the same time.
Because basically what we had was either special ed, which most of these kids were not, or we had books that were at grade level, which most of them were not, so they didn't read anything all day, and then we were shocked and surprised that their reading didn't get any better. What a surprise.
Was that the four pro or con for phonics at that time?
Well, I believed in both, so yeah. I believe whole word is very useful, because things, you know, there's an old rule in reading, a word must say what it means. So if G-O-L-D can't sound out, and it can't, there's no rule that sounds G-O-L-D out to gold. It doesn't. There's no way it could make that a long O. It can't be done. But if you read the sentence and it's about gold nuggets, you have to know that it's the word is gold. I'm on, that's all.
Okay.
So that's the whole word, and that works. But you need some phonics, too, because you need to be able to sound out words. But you don't need the old elaborate spend a million years on phonics, and that's what we're really still doing. We spend too much time on it. And not enough time on comprehension. That's my view. Anyway,
and when you were talking about getting the teachers, that was the top-down system at the time, which you wanted to get
the teachers organized
with the parents.
I wanted the parents and the teachers and the community members that cared about
the principals, the teachers,
everybody,
the parents,
to
get together
and make decisions for their own school. And so we did pass a rule that said you had to have a plan. We didn't say what had to be in the plan. Unfortunately.
I hate that word.
Very unfortunately, some of the leadership in the various district regions suggested to middle school and high schools that they get rid of their electives and have extra reading and math classes. And that was the last thing I wanted, because I wanted the kids to read.
Instead of more quality, they wanted more time.
Yes, they thought, and doing
quantity.
The same thing that they were doing that wasn't working before.
Right.
And so I was horrified at what my proposal had turned into, it really.
How many years is each term?
Four,
so you were 8 years.
Yeah, I could have served more. There was no term limits.
Right.
Julie Kornstein served in a very long time, 20 or more years.
Yeah.
But my hair started falling out. And my hair started falling out because
My
last 2 years on the school board, I was president of the board.
Mm-hmm.
And in those last 2 years, we had a great recession. Not as great as the Great Recession, but a great recession.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to be presiding over meetings that cut every fourth dollar from
the school
board.
Those 2 years were?
91 to 93. So what happened was we were destroyed financially. We had schools going on year round. We were taking people's homes.
Yeah, the housing crash of 89 was just starting to affect everything for you.
We were taking people's homes because we didn't have enough room on the campus for all the kids that were here.
Right.
We were building new schools. We were promising parents when we put bungalows on that we'd take the bungalows off, which we still have not done.
I know.
But we promised all those communities that. And my hair was falling out because I really couldn't stay. I was
stressed.
On the board at the time that LA Unified lost its instrumental music. And that killed me. That was it. I couldn't do it any longer. I said I'm either going to quit
or... my daughter used to drag the cello all the way up the hill on Mitchell from the school.
I'm telling you.
And then she decided to take
Los
violin
Angeles
because it was
Unified,
this heavy.
Until 91 to 93, had the most...
They had their own instruments.
...incredible instrumental music program in America.
Wow.
In America.
It's amazing.
We had music teachers full-time at every high school and middle school.
Yeah.
We had music teachers half to full-time, depending on school size, at every elementary school.
That's amazing.
Not only had all our own instruments, excuse me, but we had the best quality music instrument repair shop in America.
Wow.
They had every kind of tool you could find to fix and repair all of these instruments. And it was fabulous. We had big marching bands at all the high school. We had orchestras at all the high schools. We had bands and orchestras.
Didn't they all used to get together and have a competition at the Hollywood Bowl?
Oh, yes.
I went several times.
Oh, yes.
It was so exciting.
And then, of course, we cut it all.
Oh,
we destroyed it. And that was it for me. That was the last straw. We had been cut. We had been raising class size. We had been taking out the off-norm reading teachers, which I felt were so important in the elementary schools, the off-norm math teachers. We were destroying the system, and I couldn't take it. My hair literally was falling out. I went to a dermatologist to try to figure out what it was. And
stress.
Basically, that's what they said, yes. And so I was wearing a wig, literally. That much of my hair fell out. And so I said, that's it for me, and I went back to teaching.
Okay.
At the end of my second term, I didn't run again, and I taught at Grant High School in the Valley for a couple of years, and then an assembly seat came open, and I really was not interested. I'd had 8 years, because I'd never have wanted a year be in politics. I'm a teacher. I love teaching. That's who I am.
Mm-hmm.
I am a teacher. That's who I am. If you ask me, how do you identify yourself? I identify myself as a teacher.
Right.
So I went back to teaching, but I only taught 4 hours, half day, because Gloria Molina invited me to join her staff on the Board of Supervisors to be her children's deputy, to work with the foster care kids and the foster care program, and to deal with deadbeat dads or deadbeat moms who weren't paying child support, to deal with, and I also did the ethics stuff with her to try to get the board to sign on to some ethical agreements of behavior, which we never were able to accomplish. Anyway, so and we were deeply in debt. We were deeply in debt because Sharon's a writer. She only gets paid occasionally, and she did while I was on the board go back to teaching for a couple of years because the board at that time paid $12,000 a year. That's $1,000 a month before taxes.
Right.
And if you were at every meeting. So if you were sick, you got $750. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I had a back injury at one point. I got no income 1 month.
Did you have insurance?
Not really. I mean, we had no income.
Yeah.
And so we were redlined. Uh-huh. You couldn't get a loan on, we couldn't refinance the house. We couldn't get a loan. You know those things that come in the mail that say, quick cash, 12, 15, 18%? That's what I did.
Yeah.
I took out an 18% personal loan.
I remember I had two 22% loans.
And this house,
was greater
this
than
house we bought at exactly the wrong time. And because it was after Prop 13,
right.
We didn't get the Prop 13
79.
Savings. That's right. It was after it. So we didn't get the savings. And the first mortgage on this house was 11%.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we just we just were suffering. And Gloria Molina, God bless her, paid me a really good wage to work half-time there. So I would teach four classes in the morning, and then I'd drive to from the valley to the Board of Supervisors and park, and then I'd work until about 7 p.m. for her.
Sounds like your dual life when you were working in the morning and then walking the precinct.
Yeah, exactly. So I was prepared for this. And then in 93, 2 years later, a seat opened up in the state assembly in what was then the 43rd Assembly District. Now it's the 51st. Then it has different boundaries. But that was some of Silver Lake, particularly south of Sunset, a little bit around the lake itself, but not the hills of Silver Lake, was Echo Park, was Hollywood Flatlands, no hills.
Right.
It was
East Hollywood then.
No, there's a flatlands of regular Hollywood
okay.
too.
Yeah, right.
We went all the way to Highland.
Highland.
Yeah, and we had down to Santa Monica Boulevard all the way across. So I had the folks in Filipino town, and then I had still had Chinatown. But now they added Mount Washington, Highland Park, El Sereno.
And you had the corridor, the Temple Beverly corridor
yeah,
too?
Yeah. No, hold it. I'm way ahead of myself. Yeah. That's 93.
Yeah.
93, I went on the city council. I'm sorry. Yeah. That seat I did want to run for. I ran for city council. I know. Back up.
Okay, because your city council is right in the middle there between the Board
Take
of Education.
Take all this back.
Okay.
Take all this back.
So
I did go from 83 to 91 on the board. From 91 to 93, I did work at with Molina, but I ran in 93 for city council, having been convinced to do so.
Is that CD-13?
That's CD-13. I was done with politics after the 8 years on the board. Mm-hmm. I was very happy. I had a great life. Mm-hmm. I was home every night, mm-hmm. my kid, my partner. I was doing good work with Molina. I enjoyed my classes. I was team teaching.
Jump in the pool.
I was team teaching with just a delightful young English speech drama teacher. And we were team teaching a government drama, a government speech and English class.
At Grant?
At Grant for students who were intermediate bilingual kids.
Nice.
It was great fun. And then I had two other ESL classes that I taught. Okay. And I was having a wonderful time, and life was wonderful. And people kept saying, are you going to run for city council when the seat came up? I says, no, I have really no more interest to do that. Well, turned out that out of the eight people that were filing at the beginning of the filing period, there were no women. And so a whole bunch of women from the women's communities all over the city came and said, look, you know, there's only one woman on the city council now.
That was Peggy Stevenson? Joy Pikus.
Joy Pikus.
Joy Pikus.
And there's someone running against her who's a woman. And then if you ran, that would be two.
Right.
Ruth Galanter was on the council. There were two women on, but one was leaving. Mm-hmm. We weren't sure what was going to happen.
Right.
And I said, nah, I'm really not going to do it. And then there were two gay guys in the race. And some of the men in the gay community that I didn't know very well came and asked me to run because they didn't like who they thought might be one of the men that could maybe win. They thought he would embarrass the gay community. I don't think I agreed with them, but between the two groups pressuring me, Sharon and I and our son, who was in 93, a senior in high school, went away for a couple of weeks vacation, and we talked over whether I should do this or not. And finally, we agreed that I would do this. This was the most reluctant candidacy we've ever seen. The school board I was reluctant to, but I knew that we had a purpose, and I wasn't sure what the heck I would. I mean, really, give me a break. I mean, what do I know about housing and development, and I hated developers, and you know what? But I agreed. And because we had had the other campaigns, I had a lot of people willing to come together and get me elected. And so I was elected. Okay. Turned out I loved the job. I loved it because it actually has some real power.
Nice.
Each city council member really has quite a bit of power in their own district. Not, you know, you need 8 or 10, depending on if it's an ordinance, to do things citywide, but in your own district you could get a lot done, and I thought this is great. And I had staff. At the school board you don't have staff.
Right.
You know?
So you could delegate stuff.
I could get experts.
Yeah.
I could get hire community organizers.
Well, how did you focus on, like, for example, the revitalization of Hollywood that you
First of all, I hired community organizers.
And then you convinced everybody that Hollywood might have been a gold mine that we haven't looked at.
Yeah, really. Yeah,
how did you ever convince them?
Well, you know, I got lucky. I really did. I got lucky. I got lucky two ways. First, I got lucky by the earthquake. And now everybody says, how is 94? That lucky? How is that lucky? I said, well, you know what? There was a lot of trashy housing that we didn't know about until those buildings were tagged and we could go in them legally. Mm-hmm. And we realized that they were slums, and slumlords were owning them. And so we put together a task force within my office to get rid of the slumlords.
Well, you were the first to pass a slum abatement program, which really gave
the
tenants a little bit of voice and some redress.
And they pay for it.
Right.
That's how we got it passed. Mm-hmm. See, we knew that the apartment owners had too much power if they had to pay $12 a unit. Mm-hmm. But we knew that if you could tell low-income people that for $12, health and safety would be taken care of, because someone was going to inspect and fine your owner if they didn't take care of the health and safety things. No, it wouldn't make your apartment look pretty. But what we found in Hollywood, in those places, I walked into one place after the earthquake, and I stepped into the, a lot of them had a first floor of these apartment buildings was like a reception area. Chairs and tables in place so people come in and ask to see people that were living. And fleas were up to my knee just from standing, just walking into the room. I went into one of those buildings after the earthquake, and every single apartment building had holes in the walls so that if there was a water leak or something, they'd come and fix the leak.
But they wouldn't fix the
wall. But they'd never put the wall back together.
But you made the landlords accountable.
Right.
By some law or ordinance? What ordinance
was
that?
The ordinance is called the code enforcement.
Code enforcement.
Housing Code Enforcement Act. And what we said is that annually, for $12 paid by the tenants, a city housing inspector will come and look at every building. If on the first inspection everything looks perfect, they will wait 2 years before they're inspected again unless there are complaints.
Okay.
If, on the other hand, you fail the first time we come, we're going to visit you twice a year until you
pass. Every 6 months.
Okay. And so people got the hint pretty quickly that they were going to be held accountable.
Actually, landlords did go to jail, were fined.
We
did,
actually had one,
did wear ankle
we had
bracelets,
one landlord that
had to stay in,
had, you know, stay in his own slum. Yes, we did all of that. And so what I did a couple of things different on city council than most people do. First, I hired community organizers. I had some people, like my housing deputy, who was a housing expert. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I had some expertise. I had a transportation expert.
Right.
You know, so I had some experts, but then everybody else was community organizers. Okay. And so, and I paid my staff well, but some people paid their staff, in my humble opinion, too much. Mm-hmm. And it meant they didn't have very many people to answer calls from the public.
Right.
So that's the first thing, is that I had a huge staff. The second thing I did was I told all the community-based organizations that they would have my staff come to them twice a year, not every month. Ooh, God, you should have heard them scream. How will you know? I said, you have the name of the deputy that's in charge of your area. You can simply write them or call them and tell them your complaints. Mm-hmm. But here's the deal. I don't have anybody work more than an 8-hour day. If they spend 3.5 hours with you, that means that's 3.5 hours during the working day that they will not work, and that the issues that you have raised are not going to be addressed.
Right.
Wouldn't you rather they be working on fixing your issues than sitting at your meeting?
Mm-hmm.
And you get to pick which two meetings you want a year. So most of them got very hip very quickly, and had meetings in which they'd had several meetings beforehand to collect what all the issues were, and then they'd invite my staff and they'd go and we got a lot more done than everybody else because my people were not all sitting in meetings listening to people drone on and on and on. After you got the issue, you don't need to listen to all the debate about it.
Right.
Go do something about it. And the third thing that we did that was really helpful is we honored every month, every member of my staff could nominate a city employee who looked out for our district in some important way during that month. Okay, and then we would take them to one of the small restaurants in our district for lunch, and I would pay it out of my funds that I raised for office holder account.
Okay.
Nothing from the city, no public money. And I would take the staff member and the person that they nominated. I would give them a certificate. I would write their immediate supervisor and their department head and tell them what a great job they had done. And so suddenly, people in all the departments were competing to get invited to lunch.
And they were city employees.
All of them were city employees.
Didn't you do something to raise the minimum wage
for
city employees?
Yes.
Or was it, it was for city employees?
Yeah, it was
right?
for city employees.
What was that?
Well, we did a living wage ordinance.
Okay.
Which says that if you are on a contract, like all the people at the airport, most of the people in the harbor, some of the people who do grounds cleaning or things that aren't city employees, that you had to be paid a living wage. Mm-hmm. We defined a living wage, and it has a cost of living increase, and it includes a certain dollar amount per hour toward health care. I wanted to require health care, but federal law says we can't do that to vendors.
Right.
Yeah, of course, they're too powerful. So it's called ERISA, and they won't let you require it. So I said, okay, fine, I can require that you either give them cash or you find a health plan that covers these basic things, and whichever is cheaper for you, up to you. then we found that some actual city workers, not too many actually, but a few weren't making a living wage. So we then passed an ordinance that said, whatever the living wage is, no city employee can make less than that.
You really helped the average worker.
Well, it turned out
that way
that something that we did before that was better for most workers, and that was worker retention. What happened was every so many years, let's take the airport again, because that's where this all started. Let's say you're a parking lot attendant at the airport on a contract to a big company that has parking lot attendants.
Right.
Okay, bids go in after maybe 10 or 12 years, because we don't rebid those very often, and you lose the contract. Okay, now a new company comes in. All your workers are fired. They can apply to the new place, but most of the time they didn't get hired because over those 10 or 12 years their income had risen.
Right.
And these guys didn't want to pay that.
And they got the bid because it was under to begin with.
Exactly. Okay. All right. So, the first thing that we did was we passed the worker retention ordinance. Now, the worker retention ordinance says that if you are on a contract as a city employee, not a city employee, to a vendor that has a contract with the city, and this is before living wage, you may not be laid off for the first 60 days of the new hire unless the positions change in the new hire. Okay. So for example, if you were a food service worker and you were making crepes, but the new chef needed to be able to make burritos, not crepes, they would be allowed to lay you off and hire a burrito maker.
Uh-huh.
Okay. If you were a parking lot employee though, they had to keep you for 60 days. Unless you didn't show up for work, you were caught stealing, you did something that would get anybody fired under any set of circumstances. Mm-hmm. So there was no guarantee even for anybody. But for most people who weren't doing any of those things, they got 60 days. At the end of 60 days, the employer had to give in writing to the employee the reason why they were not up to their standard to continue on as employees. We couldn't force them to keep them.
Right.
Okay, they fought this tooth and nail. Turned out it saved them a fortune.
A ton of money.
Because they never had to go through a whole training process. Mm-hmm. These folks already knew what to do.
So it's called the worker retention
ordinance. WRO. Turns out for the average employee of a vendor, that was the best thing that ever happened to him, better than even the living wage, and here's why. A lot of them, after many years, were making enough with their partner, either husband or wife, working somewhere else, to buy a small home. They could never get a loan. Because as long as they were employed by vendors, yeah, they knew that they'd be laid off every few years.
It's like and a 1099.
They couldn't ever get a loan. Now, with worker retention, they could go in and say, I'm guaranteed my job unless I screw up, which is true of everybody. Okay? And boomity, boomity, boom. So I got more letters from people at the airport and the harbor thanking me for the worker retention than even for the living wage.
Wow. Yeah.
Even the living wage.
That makes sense.
And out of that came then the living wage idea when we realized that the whole point of what was happening was the underbidders were bidding what the wages were when the current contractor started, so that they kept bringing everybody back down to the lowest possible place.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's when we put in the work. And also Baltimore had already passed a very small but a narrow living wage ordinance, and so we had two big studies, and we had 9 months of hearings, and
you were reelected.
Oh yes,
To 2 4-year.
2 4-years, and because Reardon had put on the ballot the year I ran, that since he could only serve two terms, that council members could only serve two terms, and it passed. I was term limited in 2000.
Was he the mayor the whole time you were there?
Yes. Oh my God.
What do you think?
It was awful. It was really awful.
He
tried to privatize virtually everything. Privatize the library, privatize the airport, privatize the port, privatize DWP. We were able to stop him, but he was a big privatizer. That's really what happened. At the end of 2000, a seat opened up in the assembly. And I had really wanted to go back to teaching.
Mm-hmm.
And this was, of the three races, the most reluctant.
Mm-hmm.
Because I really didn't want to go to Sacramento. First of all, I had been in nonpartisan politics. And even though everybody knew who was Democrats and who was Republicans, and even though there were conservatives and liberals and moderates and centrists, you did not have party rule
and
party line.
You were kind of an independent.
You were very independent.
Mm-hmm.
You made alliances based on agreement, not on party
and
lines.
People and ethics,
right,
not on
exactly.
Names.
Right. So, I really didn't want to do this. But it turned out that a person who was in the city council race held a grudge against me and decided to run somebody that was in his immediate circle for that seat, and to raise a lot of money and to try to keep me from doing it. I didn't want it, and I really wasn't interested in it, but again, a lot of people prevailed, and they prevailed on me about one thing, that we couldn't get any movement on a bond issue that would get us out of the overcrowding in the schools.
Right.
And they said, you don't have to get anything else done. If you can get something done that will get us to build schools, it'll be worth you spending a couple
years. You didn't have too much time
there.
Between the city council and November, right?
Yes, exactly.
So you had like maybe a couple of months.
Well,
about four months.
But,
even get elected.
I was pretty sure I would win. I was pretty sure I would win because people had in the district, which was a lot of the same, only now included, which hadn't been on city council, Highland Park, Mount Washington, El Sereno.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, a little tiny bit of Boyle Heights, but not much. It's the corner of it. I got talked into it, and this was the most reluctant race I ever ran. I really did not want to do this. I didn't want to go to Sacramento, but Sheila Kuehl was the one that talked me into it. She came here and had dinner with Sharon and I, and she said, look, you want to do something about a bond issue, you have to be here, because nobody else is going to do that.
Was it the LA City Council where you had a movement to ban the Saturday night specials?
Yes.
And was that the 25 millimeter with the magazine?
Yeah.
And that passed?
Yes.
Is that in the city of Los Angeles?
Yes.
And
you
it's still in
effect? You can't buy one, you can't own one, you can't use one.
Does that include anything above 25 millimeter?
It's anything that could be defined as a Saturday night special. And there are different definitions. I
22?
Don't know.
But at the time, a Saturday night special was a 25 millimeter.
Right. But the
a lot of people
city
are getting actually shot by
the
these
city
things.
Attorney. A lot of people are shot by those because they're small and concealable.
Right.
And the worst part about it is they are dangerous even if you're not a villain.
Right.
Because they explode. They're poorly made.
Mm-hmm.
And they do explode in your hand. I mean, I had people come and show me pictures of things that had happened decided to do that.
Wow.
So it's not a frequent occasion. I don't want to mislead anybody. It's not like it happened
every
time.
They
were very cheap. They were
firearms
tiny.
That were concealable.
They were concealable.
And, the bad guys had them.
And they were dangerous. And they were dangerous even if you weren't a bad guy.
Mm-hmm.
And I had wanted to go further, but by this time my term was ending.
But you did get that passed.
Yes, I did. It was city law.
Right.
And I got the whole domestic partner stuff done in the city.
So that the domestic partners of the same gender could be have the same civil rights and responsibilities as anybody else.
Well, we couldn't do responsibilities because we don't do that. That took me. I did that at the state level.
Right.
All I could do was say they got the same benefits.
Okay.
The identical benefits, both in retirement as well as health care, dental care, vision care, time off for bereavement, whatever it was. They got the same thing.
Family leave,
all of it.
Terrific.
So those were the major achievements. Yeah. And then, of course, I thought we did quite a bit of fixing up the neighborhood. We planted thousands of trees. We built about 1,800 units of affordable housing. We built special needs housing for AIDS people and people with mental illnesses.
There was a huge revitalization movement that you spearheaded
Hollywood. We did Hollywood.
We did Hollywood big time. And now here we're going to have the Oscars in a week, and have the results.
Well, that was one of our goals. But we figured you had to fix all three parts of Hollywood. You had to fix the housing. You had to fix the entertainment part that you went to.
Right.
It had to be things you wanted to go to do and see. And we needed to fix the industry part of it, which said that there was a place for people to make records and music and film in terms of sound studios and Paramount.
Nice.
I helped Paramount get permits to do all the things they wanted to do there.
Wow.
And and in return, we started the after-school program, LA Center. It was first the LA Center for Education Research. Now it's, LA. CER, what is it?
It's, LASER?
Yeah, our after-school programs at our four middle schools in the area and the two high schools, Fairfax and Hollywood High.
You originally wanted every after-school to have...
Yes.
That was the original
yes.
goal, which
yes.
is still ongoing,
right.
You still head up as a co-president
right.
of the LASER
right.
Foundation.
No, I'm vice president.
Vice president.
Sharon's secretary.
But you're the founder.
Sharon and I. Sharon did all the work.
Co-founder.
Sharon did all the work.
Okay.
She did all the work. She ran it. The whole time I was on city council, she did not take a salary and worked 16 hours a day.
And that was your get back for all of the cuts.
Yes, right. Well, what
the 90s.
She didn't take a salary not only because we didn't have money at first, but because we were getting a small money from the city for after school programs. And even though technically speaking, since we were not married, there would have been, quote, no conflict of interest. We felt it was a conflict of interest for me to vote on funds that would help pay her salary.
Right.
So she earned not a dime, which, of course, affects her Social Security and all of those other things for all those years that she did that from 94 to 2001. 7 years she worked for no income.
Wow. And you were an assemblywoman by 2000.
Yeah.
And at that time, you were working with the then speaker, was it Robert Hertzberg?
Right.
And you got together and decided that classrooms were too full.
What I said to Robert.
Things were
what
going
I said
crazy
to,
in the school
system. What I said to
system.
Robert, because Robert Hertzberg was going to be the author of the next bond issue.
Okay.
And I said to him, I am not usually a threatening person, but I am today. So let me tell you what the problem is. The problem is that the state allocation board allocates bond money first come, first serve. Okay? So as soon as a district owns all the property it needs to build and has drawings for what it wants to build, it can apply for funding to build a school. LA has no vacant property. So while we're amassing property, Moreno Valley, which was empty at the time, builds all new schools. Murrieta, the city, not Murrieta Hot Springs, the retirement village, but the city, builds all new schools. Builds schools before the houses are built. Their schools were there sitting empty because they were in line and they could show there would be people, and they got
the
money.
And they had the wherewithal.
And here's the irony of it all. All those districts that were getting the money voted against every bond issue.
I know.
And Los Angeles, which voted in such large numbers in favor of it, never got a dime. So I said to him, here's what I'm going to do, Bob. We don't fix this problem for LA, Anaheim, Fresno. There were about six districts that were in the same boat we were in. We don't fix it for these that are severely overcrowded, landlocked, and can't get any money. If we don't fix it, I will organize a campaign in Los Angeles against the bond issue. Because nobody's going to get schools if we can't get schools. And I said, I want to tell you something. I'm very good, you know that I am, as an organizer. But it'll still pass Los Angeles. But we will reduce the passage rate by enough that it won't pass statewide. So he put me on, as a freshman in my first year, on the Joint Assembly Senate Committee that wrote the bill.
Right.
And what we wrote into the bill was that there would be two huge bond issues, one a year later and 1 2 years after that. And in each bond issue, a portion of the money would be set aside for what was called severely overcrowded school districts. And we set up what they were, so there was no fooling around. You couldn't call yourself that. There were criteria. And it was, I think, we came out with 8 or 10 schools, districts in the whole state that were severely overcrowded. That money could only be used for their schools. And they had 10 years to access it, which meant they had 10 years to buy up what they needed, get the plans done, and go after that money. And nobody could touch it. No matter what else they wanted to do, it could not be allocated. That's how Anaheim, Fresno, at the time part of Oxnard, North San Diego County, LA Unified, and I think there were one or two others somewhere else, finally got to build out of their overcrowding. So that's what I came to do, and I did a few other things while I was there, including the all-but-marriage domestic partner bill, right, which was marriage by any other name. And the only thing we didn't get in California, if you had been married, you would have gotten everything that we got except for you couldn't file your taxes jointly in California. Right. And the only reason we didn't get that was that Gray Davis said he had promised that if he supported this by signing it, it would not cost the state anything. Okay? And he could, and there was no way to get a survey done in time to find out if that would cost. We didn't know. I mean, maybe it wouldn't, maybe it would, no one knew. So we left that out, and 2 years later, another assembly member got that done too. Mm-hmm. So we had, and an interesting thing was, we had it signed, but we didn't have it go into effect for 2 years. And the reason we didn't have it go into effect for 2 years was that prior to this measure, there were a lot of incremental improvements for domestic partners who were signed up with the Secretary of State, and there were no responsibilities. Mm-hmm. Marriage, you got kids, you got property, you got things. There are responsibilities, okay?
Right.
None were in that because we weren't doing marriage. Okay, so we thought we better have the gay and lesbian community have 2 years to know that if you are now registered as a domestic partner, you got responsibility, you got property, it's now community property. Your partner's going to get half of it if you divorce. You got kids, you got child support issues and custody questions, okay? Not the biological parent gets to sneak off with them and the other parent never gets to see the kids again.
You chaired that committee, right?
Huh?
What, we
no,
were,
no, I didn't. It was my bill.
It was your bill.
It was my bill. So those were my two big accomplishments, the bond issue and that. I did a bunch of other smaller things, which I'm very proud of, but those were the two things. And then I was term limited. 2 years later, Carol Liu was going to run for the Senate seat that encompassed my area, and I said, it's yours, darling. I'm not interested.
So it was two-year terms?
Three.
Three two-year terms.
I didn't
want
to go back for the third one because, boy,
but you
Schwarzenegger.
Didn't go back for the third one.
Schwarzenegger,
so it was only two.
No, I did. I went
you
back.
You did go back
I,
for the
I
third.
Did. I got talking.
Because you had Gray Davis, and then...
No, yeah, I got Gray Davis. No, Schwarzenegger.
Oh, no.
And the first year that Schwarzenegger won, he vetoed 14 bills out of 14 bills of mine. He vetoed one bill that did nothing.
Just to veto it?
Just to veto it. Just so that he could tell me.
Did you, that was a question I wanted to ask you about harassment. Did you feel you were, because of your gender or because of your
I would say in the assembly, the right-wing fundamentalist Republicans were disgusting.
Okay.
They were absolutely disgusting. And I was in tears a lot at first. I mean, Sheila kept leaving the Senate to come over and comfort me. I was in tears a lot because... Here, there may be people who were homophobic, but they didn't say it out loud.
Mm.
There they were proud of it. They were doing God's work.
And this is in the 2000
this
to
is
2006.
2000, this is 2000 to 2006.
This is pretty recent.
Yes. They're still there.
Yeah.
And now a lot of the ones that were with me are now in Congress, those right-wing SOBs. So, no, I was not happy there. I really never wanted to be there. I was sorry I was there. But I did do two things that were important, so I now no longer say I'm sorry I went. I'm glad I went. You know, we've lived in this house since 79. We owe more on it now than when we bought it because it's put people through college. Yeah. It's bought homes for our foster kids. It's bought a home for my kid. And
how many foster kids?
We had two foster kids.
And they grew up here and...
Well, actually, they didn't stay with us very long. When one of their parents was ill and one of their parents was incarcerated, when the ill one got better, they went back with her.
Mm-hmm.
They were sorry later.
Mm-hmm.
We still have connections with the one that's in Muncie, and I have with them three grandchildren there as well.
Lovely.
But we don't see them very often.
So when you finished in 2006... You started the LAUSD, or you took
LAUSD
left off?
No. We,
how did that
work? I'd been on the board all of that time.
All that time.
Sharon stayed running.
So you were doing
until
that concurrently.
About 7 years ago.
Yeah.
I don't do the day-to-day stuff. Sharon does the day-to-day stuff.
Right.
I'm a fundraiser.
Right.
And I work on issues that come up.
In fact,
we
met each other, I think, at a Russ Feingold clean money thing.
Oh, yeah.
And... you could talk a little bit about Citizens United and fundraising for clean money and do the Twain meet or...
Yeah. Well, I do a lot of fundraising for a lot of groups. I probably spoke at every Sheila Kuehl fundraiser. I'm a great fundraiser. I do it very well with people. Because I remind them that you're not giving the money to Sheila or to me or to and Citizens United or to... any of the causes I support, you're giving money to make a change in the way something you don't like is going on, or something you do want to see happen, something positive you want to see happen, has a chance to happen if this person can get elected. And I remind people of that, and it helps people realize that it's an investment in their civic society, their civic life, and I can usually get people to be more generous when they think about it in a slightly different way. That this really isn't for Sheila.
Right.
It's for what a person with her knowledge and her intelligence could do for the county of Los Angeles that you live in, whether you live in her district or not. And I did some fundraising for Hilda Solis as well.
Uh-huh.
You know, and you do those things because it matters what people do who are in public office.
Right.
It just matters. Local politics is better than state and national politics because it's nonpartisan. If I could get rid of one thing, I'd get rid of political parties. I'd say you can't run on as a party member.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to run on something, you could run on a liberal or a conservative or a reactionary or a radical platform, and you could get people to sign up for that platform and run together as a team. I'm not saying you couldn't do that. But you couldn't run as a Democrat or a Republican or...
Get rid of the black and white hats.
Well, get rid of the notion that you have to defend your party rather than your city.
Or my father, or my grandfather, or my great-grandfather were all.
Right.
And if you have people watching this video, like that are, let's say, millennials or people that are just beginning to start to vote, and what would be your advice for them to get involved? Would it be like
I would urge all people to at least sign up with two or three of the sites that give you information. Mm-hmm. Whether it's Truth Out or Move On, or I'm on about 12 or 13 of them. I don't read them every day. I don't have time, but I get them. I think if we're going to remain in a party system, I'd advise them to join a local Democratic Party group. And I think we need to do to the Democratic Party what the right wing did to the Republican Party. The progressives need to take over the Democratic Party. Well, you can only do that by going to the meetings and being in clubs and going to conventions and outvoting the people who think that the only way to win is to be in the dead center right. Mm-hmm. Dead center right doesn't move the agenda forward. Mm-hmm. It doesn't.
What does?
Being center left and left. Mm-hmm. And sticking to your guns and deciding that, I think the thing that made me the most powerful elected official that I was I didn't care if I got reelected. As soon as you give up caring about reelection, you can be really good.
You sold your soul.
You're gone. You're just
yeah.
good.
Yeah.
I mean, I was sort of throw me in the briar patch, really? Oh, really? You're going to send me back to teaching? Oh, horror! My God! You're going to send me back to the classroom? My God, my God. In fact, one of the years near the end of my first term in City Hall when I was really missing the classroom, my staff changed my office into a classroom. They set up chairs and desks. They put a blackboard in. They had little notebooks. They had me come in and give a little presentation and teach them a lesson on history. And they said, see, you could do it here.
Right,
you don't
home.
Have to go back to the classroom. We can make it here. That's really was my only regret. I missed being a career teacher. Mm-hmm. I did. I taught for about 20 years. But I really would. I another had another 20 in me to go. I really did.
Are you interested?
So then I went into teaching at UCLA.
Yeah, that's what I was going to.
Yeah, so that helped me a little, but it's not the same. It's not the same. These graduates kids are great, and they're going to be wonderful, socially just, socially conscious teachers. Mm-hmm. But they didn't need me. The kids I taught needed me, and it's a different level of commitment. It's a commitment that says that you have something important to do and you need to be focused on that.
And you can do it.
And I could do it. Yeah. So this never pleased me as much, but it still got me in classrooms every day because I was supervising student teachers as well as teaching their seminar. Right. And so I was in classrooms every day. I love being in classrooms with students because I'd sit in the back and help some of the ones that were struggling while my student teachers were teaching. And it was great stuff. And so now I'm working on a small consultant contract, which I think is just about up for the mayor's office. Mm-hmm. And we're working on service restoration and workforce restoration. And the mayor has asked me to use my connections with the community colleges and the workforce centers and LA Unified's adult ed and the departments of the city to put together a plan over the next 4 or 5 years to hire 5,000 new city employees, but from low-income neighborhood communities, from places like Trade Tech College, which is almost entirely low-income kids, or Faye Washington's YWCA programs, which are 80% former foster kids, and to gang kids, and adults who come out of prison and can't find jobs because nobody will hire them with a prison record. So we're developing a system that I started when I was on the city council when we were rebuilding Hollywood called the vocational worker. Mm-hmm. The vocational worker does not have to pass a civil service test to get hired.
Right.
But they come in and they are in a trainee position. They make 6 to 8% less than the starting salary of the position they're aiming for. So it's not a big drop, but it's a little savings. And they get a supervisor that will work with them and train them on the job. And they get 6 to 18 months to learn all the things they need to know. And we can even extend it past 18, but the goal is 6 to 18 months. Easier skilled jobs, 6 months, we should regularize them. Then they get regularized into the step one of a position.
Okay.
And we have 6 of these trainee positions. Mm-hmm. And they're being now resurfaced at the Civil Service Commission this Thursday. And then the mayor's office is identifying over the next 5 years potential sources of funding. So we're going to look at the homeless, recently homeless. Mm-hmm. We're going to look at those recently returning from prison. We're going to look at people who are limited English speakers. Unfortunately, we can't hire people who aren't citizens. Mm-hmm. There are a few positions we can hire people with green cards on, mm-hmm. so that we're looking at a little bit. Mm-hmm. But we can't hire anybody really without documents.
Are they over 18 or 21?
They have to be 18.
18.
A few of them require driver's license, not too many. Mm-hmm. A couple of them are in sensitive positions with the public, which we would not allow people with criminal right. records in. But others are, you know, if you're carving a curb cut in a street for the Disability Americans with Disability Act, right. you're not interacting with anything but cement right. and other city workers, we're right. going to take a chance on you.
Right.
So that's what I'm doing now, and I'm really establishing the networks and getting people connected to mm-hmm. each other. And then once that happens, then I don't know what I'm going to do next. I'll see.
Well, that's going to continue on.
Yeah. Oh, I intend, I'm not ready to retire, but I'm not ready to work full-time any longer either. Mm-hmm. So
you're semi-retired.
I'm about 50%. I probably work about a half a day. Mm-hmm. I do a lot with my grandkids, as you can see. We have them 5 days a week, 4 during the week and 1 on Sunday afternoons.
Oh.
And we love them dearly, and they spend an overnight every Friday night here, and gives everybody else a chance for a little break from the kiddies, and we love it, and they love it, and we have a good time. So basically, life is good for us. We're knock on wood, but I have a pension from the city of Los Angeles.
Right.
Most of my friends have no pension.
Right.
And their Social Security ain't going to do it for them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they've put money aside. A lot of them even have 401ks. But I have an 84-year-old friend, good friend, in pretty good health. She's going to last a while longer. She's getting her last payment from her 401k next month.
And no Social Security?
She has Social Security,
but
it's about $1,100.
Yeah.
How's she going to live? How's she going to live?
What about all those people that are super wealthy and still take their Social Security?
Yeah.
They cannot not take their Social Security.
Well, I don't object to that. The only thing I object to about Social Security is a cap on how much they take, how high your income is. It stops at $250,000. We should be taking money out however much they earn, and it should be not just earnings from wages. It should be earnings of any type.
Yeah.
Then
mm-hmm.
Social Security would have no problem at all. None whatsoever.
Isn't it supposed to be more like a safety net so that if you're older and you have you're not needing it, you wouldn't have to take it?
No. Actually, it was intended to be income
for everybody.
It was intended to be a retirement from system for people who didn't get a retirement.
That's right. For people that actually
had no pension.
Who needed it.
That's right.
It's a safety net.
It was a desire to get older people from stop eating cat food and dog food for dinner.
And there are still many, many older people in this city that have empty refrigerators.
It's better than it was, but it's not good enough. And this business of frightening young people to say it won't be there is crazy, because of course it'll be there for them.
Right. So we've got ways to go.
Yeah, we've got ways to go. But I tell everybody, if I were, knock on wood against it, have a heart attack and die tomorrow, I could really say that I've lived a happy and fruitful life.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that really that's what people want. They mm-hmm. want to say they've made a contribution.
Right.
So you ask me and I'll finish with that.
Yeah.
Young people, get involved in something.
Right.
Get involved in something. If it's your local school, get involved in your local
volunteer.
School. Volunteer. Volunteer, organize around issues around your school. Get involved, join a Democratic club.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you're registered independent,
mm-hmm.
register Democrat and join a Democratic club, because if you want the Democratic Party to be better, you got to do it yourself. Ain't nobody else going to do it for you. Vote in every election. Get everyone you know to vote in every election. If there's nobody on the ballot that you like, turn in a blank ballot. Mm-hmm. I don't care. Mm-hmm. But you see, here's what's happened. Why do they cut things that involve children first? Mm-hmm. Because youth don't vote. The 18 mm-hmm. to 25-year-olds vote much less than every other age group. Okay? If all of them voted, do you think that there would be tuition at UC and CSU and community colleges? Of course not. Legislators in Sacramento know they can cut funding, and may you pay more and more, and maybe even price you out of a higher education, because you won't do anything about it. You don't vote. If every 18 to 25-year-old voted, there'd be no tuition in public universities and colleges in California. There would be not a single dime. Period. But
and sometimes they don't know who to vote for, so they can always call you, Jackie.
Well, yeah, they can call me, and they can sign up and get be on my ballot. I send out ballot advice every year. They could do that, absolutely. But most importantly, you have to be involved in a group of people who want to make change. Mm-hmm. You can't do it alone, and you can't hope that somebody else is going to do it for you.
Right. Thank you so much, Jackie. It's been a pleasure. Really enjoyed interviewing you.
Thank you.
You've contributed so much to protect all of us, just like your little protection over your door. I appreciate it.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.